Hello everyone and welcome to Tika Talks Food. Today, for a change, instead of talking about food, I'm going to be talking about sleep. Now, why am I talking about sleep when I'm a dietitian, and why today specifically? It is because today, November 7th, marks the start of fallback, which is the time of the year when about 70 countries that practice something called daylight savings roll back their clock by 1 hour. Now, theoretically, that seems like a good thing because it sounds like we're gonna get an extra hour of sleep. But according to sleep experts, whenever the clock gets adjusted this way, people actually develop circadian misalignment, or rather their circadian rhythm is disrupted. So what is circadian rhythm and how is that gonna affect food, nutrition, metabolic health, etc.? So circadian rhythms are physical, mental, and behavioral changes that follow a 24-hour cycle. So basically things like, you know, when you sleep, what you eat, and how your mood is, etc. These are all affected by circadian rhythms. And if any one part of it gets affected, the other part inevitably gets affected. So if sleep gets affected, your mood gets affected, and your food choice gets affected because your appetite is affected. If your appetite's affected, sleep can get affected. So it kind of goes in that cycle. So any one piece being misaligned at this point can actually affect the other. And chronically, this can affect health. Now, how does this affect those of us who don't live in countries that have the daylight savings time? Well, we're self-inducing circadian misalignment by doing shift work. So we're talking, you know, workers who work in jobs that require you to disrupt your sleep as a result of work schedules. We're also talking about those of us who live in a country but work in jobs that have working hours in different time zones, which has become more and more common as a result of COVID and as a result of extended work from home. How many of you know friends, colleagues, and loved ones who work in, you know, who live in Asia but work in the US time zone, who live in the US but work in Europe time zone, or work with colleagues in South America, etc.? So all of this are, you know, all of these are actually ways that we're disrupting our sleep. So today I'll talk about sleep hygiene and how we can use some strategies to help maintain some semblance of good sleep patterns in order to at least reduce the damage caused by circadian misalignment. Okay, number one, in terms of sleep hygiene. Now, caffeine. So caffeine is a wonderful thing that we all use as a stimulant to help us get going. But the reality is that if we consume caffeine-containing foods closer to bedtime, it is a big one that can actually disrupt our sleep further. So cutting off caffeine about 6 hours before bedtime is a wonderful strategy to help get the benefits of caffeine by having it earlier in the day when most of us are working, without the damage of caffeine, which tends to be sleep disruption. And this includes things like Coca-Cola, Diet Coke, things like chocolate and dark chocolate, right? Most people, when they think caffeine, they think coffee, tea, but some of these other foods also contain caffeine. So cutting it out 6 hours before bedtime, strategy number one. Number two, now this seems a little bit counterintuitive, and especially as the weather gets a little bit colder, a lot of us tend to indulge in more alcohol than usual. And a lot of people would say, hey, you know what? If I have a glass of wine, I actually sleep better. What studies are showing is that even though you tend to fall asleep a little bit quicker when you have alcohol, the sleep quality is actually negatively impacted by alcohol. So a lot of you who have faced hangovers before, the reason you feel very hungry the next day after a hangover is because of the fact that your sleep is disrupted and your stress hormones such as cortisol goes up because your body didn't get that rejuvenation that it needs from a good night's rest. And so the next day morning, it feels more agitated and is craving more sugar as a coping mechanism. All right, so avoiding alcohol as much as possible, or also spacing it away as much as possible from sleep, is better. So oftentimes people would argue, well, but the guidelines say that men can have 2 drinks a night and women can have 1 drink a night, don't they? Well, yes, that might be the guideline, but in general, most practitioners are shifting towards working on alcohol frequency rather than quantity. What does that mean? It means you are better off having 1 or 2 drinks 1 or 2 nights a week rather than having it every night a week, which means that you are actually disrupting your sleep every night of the week, even if you're just having a half a glass of wine every night. So essentially, I would much rather you have one or two glasses and enjoy it over the weekend than have it every day and disrupt your sleep. That doesn't mean that if you don't drink alcohol that you should actually start drinking alcohol. But it is a factor that does tend to disrupt sleep and as a result disrupt your mood and potentially your food choices the next day. And if this is a habit that you are cultivating and are having every night, you can see how in the long run it can cause more than just liver damage. It can cause just sleep circadian rhythm damage. The next thing that we need to look at when it comes to sleep hygiene is actually restricting in-bed activity. So a lot of us, as a result of working from home, have occasionally cultivated the habit of working from bed. So if we're not in a meeting or something, a lot of us tend to like answer emails from bed, or we're staring at our phone and we're texting work colleagues, etc. So trying your best to create this division between bedtime activities versus work time activities is really important, because psychologically it helps create that barrier and it helps create boundaries. A big part of sleep is also getting into that routine and calming down and getting ready to allow your body to rejuvenate. If your mind is constantly active at that point, it is going to be very difficult for your body to shut down. Okay, the next one is quite obvious, which is cutting out digital devices about 30 to 60 minutes before bedtime. Now, this is mainly because it does the opposite of what sun exposure does. So sun exposure basically tells our body that it's daytime. And when our body knows it's daytime, it ultimately prepares that it'll be nighttime and bedtime about 7 or 8 hours later, right? When we start exposing ourselves to bright lights later at night, it's gonna affect our melatonin production. Melatonin is basically the sleep time hormone. It's a hormone that tells our body it's time to sleep. So when we expose ourselves to device light later at night, it confuses our body into thinking that it's daytime, and it's gonna cause more difficulty in falling asleep. And if you have difficulty falling asleep, then you naturally control the number of hours that you're gonna get to sleep, because most of us have to wake up the next day morning at a fixed time to start working. Now, this is a good segue to our next point about sleep hygiene. As much as work is restrictive to this for a lot of us, maintaining a relatively stable sleep and wake time routine is imperative. Now, I'm guilty of this myself. A lot of us have a weekday routine when it comes to sleep and a weekend routine when it comes to sleep, right? Like, we may be like an 11 to 6 sleeper on weekdays, whereas in the weekend, we might be like a 1 a.m. to 10 a.m. sleeper. And that is a pattern that is very unhelpful when it comes to maintaining good circadian rhythm. So trying your best to maintain sort of a 30 minute to 1 hour window in which you fall asleep and 30 minute to 1 hour window in which you wake up is essential. So it's not gonna happen overnight, but this is a practice that if you make a point to try adopting over time, you can adjust your sleep time and wake times by like 15 to 30 minute intervals. It will make a huge impact in the long run, because reality is that habits don't happen overnight. They're cultivated over time. You didn't get to your current sleep pattern overnight, right? And so anyway, studies are showing that it can take up to 3 weeks to adjust to a new time zone or a new time shift like daylight savings. So yeah, give yourself time, be kind to yourself, but definitely set those limitations. The last thing, and this is where I come into food, is basically trying your best to finish up your last meal or snack for the day 2 to 3 hours before bedtime, and making sure that that meal is not too spicy, acidic, or too greasy. The reality is that all of these things can cause gastric content to come up to your throat. And you know, greasy food takes a little bit longer to digest as well, which means it's gonna slow down gastric emptying. So you're basically going to bed with a more full stomach, which is something that can also disrupt sleep. The other thing that the Sleep Foundation says is we tend to have poorer quality sleep when we go to bed with higher glucose levels. So if we have a meal later, and naturally meals are gonna cause glucose levels to go up because most of our meals tend to contain some amount of carbohydrates, essentially what's gonna happen is we're gonna go to bed with elevated glucose levels, and that's not good for sleep quality. So giving yourself that 2 to 3 hour window to digest the food can be a useful strategy to also help improve your sleep quality later on. The other thing is also 15 to 20 minute walks post dinner. So postprandial walks are wonderful to facilitate digestion. They're great to actually stabilize blood sugar. So those of us who are having trouble controlling blood sugar levels, this can be a great strategy as well. And it is a great mental health strategy. So it's a nice wind down to tell you, you know what? I ate, I'm thankful for today. I'm thankful for all the activity I engaged in today. I'm gonna facilitate my body's digestion, cool down, and get ready for bed, right? And it's a good way to just cultivate that habit as well. So even if during the day you're not able to get as much exercise, at least you know you're always gonna get that 15 minutes of walk after dinner, because it's gonna help with digestion and it's gonna help with sleep. Okay, so you know, today's video was gonna be less content heavy when it came to nutrition and more conceptual, such as, you know, just talking about sleep and how it can impact nutritional decisions. Okay, you know, talk to me in this video about what are some ways you have felt sleep being impacted. What are some of the sleep hygiene strategies that you never really thought about that you'd like to discuss? And also tell me, you know, what are other aspects of nutrition and food you want me to discuss?
Sleep well tonight and all the nights coming forward. Give yourself time to readjust, and I'll see you again with more content.
Please like the page and give me comments on what else you would like to talk about, and I'll see you in your next video. Take care. Bye.